I don't know if it was the smartest or the stupid thing to do, but I came across a very cheap Tesla Model S motor and I've decided to buy it. And would you believe it, it did turn up. And here we go, this is the motor behind me.
The package with the motor arrived a week earlier, but I did not have an opportunity to start working on it. But once I had a little bit of time, I started unpacking the package with excitement and worry mixed together, compared perhaps with anticipation of a great Christmas present, while worrying that it might be just another pair of woolly socks. I was quite pleased with my initial observations, as there were no sign of any damaged parts. The only downside was clearly visible signs of the aluminium corrosion on some surfaces of the motor. And the great extra bonus, the high voltage cable was completely intact.
And the good news, we have this mounting bracket, which basically mounts on this side of the motor. And this is fantastic because this will definitely help me with my project. This is the motor part and this is the inverter part. So we need to gain access to the inverter in this case.
My goal for this task is to remove Tesla inverter cover, but to gain access to the cover, I first will need to remove the cooling pipes and the black foam cover that isolates the inverter top. I also decided to remove high voltage cables to make my life easier later on. I realized how inadequate my tool was for taking the side bracket off. Tesla definitely required something a bit more powerful. At this point, surely you may say, now it's a time to remove the inverter cover. Well, unfortunately not quite yet. This little orange cup is covering the three-phase connection from the motor to the inverter. Until those three connections are done, it would be impossible to separate inverter from the motor. I tried poking this cup with a screwdriver. Fortunately, I discovered that it has screws fixing it to the motor before I managed to break anything. And of course Tesla don't want you to go there. Since you peel off the label, you are presented with lots of warranty void messages on the label itself. I have undone the screws and removed the cup, which gave me access to the three-phase cables coming from the motor. I removed the screws securing the cables for the phase 1, 2 and 3 to the inverter, and now we are ready to remove the inverter. After all this, unbolting inverter was a very straightforward exercise. The only sticky part was unplugging a temperature sensor connector and encoder connector that comes from the cable within the motor itself. With the inverter removed, I couldn't help but admire the incredible level of technology Tesla had even in 2013 when this car was built.
During the video, I was referring to this as an inverter cover because it's so small, it looks like cover, but actually, this is the whole inverter in here, including power transistors, processor board and everything else. So these are three-phase output that actually go to the motor itself. Let's have a look and compare this with the Toyota Prius inverter. Ta-da! I'm even struggling to lift it up. So this is Toyota Prius inverter in comparison, only capable of 50 watt max. Compare this with Tesla, capable of 250 watt peak power. To be totally objective, Toyota Prius inverter has two inverters inside, and we do have two connections for two motors, MG1 and MG2, as well as DC to DC converter. But still, 50 watt max peak power here, and 250 watt max peak power in this one. Now I can focus on removing the top board from here. I need to remove the whole bottom plate and the board together because the bottom plate has current sensors embedded in the plate and they are soldered straight to the board. So my task would be to remove the plate with the board and unsolder the current sensors. And to do this, I will have to remove these as well. You might be wondering how much did this cost me in the end. As I mentioned in my previous video, I might have to pay input duty and VAT, which turned out to be not exactly true. I only had to pay a VAT. There was no input duty on this type of goods imported into the UK, so I ended up paying VAT. VAT was about 200 euros, which turned out about around roughly 180 pounds-ish. So the total cost of this was around 700 plus 180 pounds, so 880 pounds, which turned out to be quite a good bargain in the end anyway.
Taking into account that I also received completely intact high voltage cable and mounting brackets for the motor, take into account that these items could have been excluded from the purchase and I would have to pay £300 to £400 for them as well, actually gives me quite a good feeling about this one, obviously provided that the motor is working.